in our little chapel this morning. As people are coming in, would you guys just stand in your seats, give somebody a high five and a handshake, give them a hug, let them know that you are glad that they are here and to come expecting something amazing from an incredible God.
Good morning. Welcome to Little Chapel Church. We're glad you're here this morning as we encounter God together. If you're new with us this week, we'd love to give you some more information about what we have to offer here. So if you would take out your phone and text the word welcome to our number 618-777-6779, we'll get more information to you this week. We're continuing our Parents Weekend in the Hangar this month. Today is the day for parents of second and third grade children. So if you have kids in second or third grade, you're going to want to head out to the hangar right now and see everything that's going on as they encounter God together. The schedule for the remainder of the month is on the screen. We want you to be a part of what your kids are experiencing today. Coffee, Word, and Prayer for our men's ministry continues each Saturday at 6 a.m. It's a great time of fellowship. Men, you don't want to miss it. Plan to be here next Saturday at 6 a.m. for this special time to get together. Our Family Fall Festival is scheduled for October 23rd from 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. This is for kids and families, anybody who wants to attend. We're going to have a chili cook-off. If you'd like to participate in that, stop by the Connect Desk this morning to sign up. It's going to be a great time for families to come together in fellowship. Danny Gokey tickets are still on sale. He'll be with us on November 16th at 7 p.m. Tickets are $20 each. You can purchase them at the Connect Desk or online. We'd like to remind you about our prayer ministry called The Furnace. Each week we email out prayer requests, and if you feel led to pray over the needs of Little Chapel and our surrounding communities, please be a part of The Furnace. Here's how you can get involved. You can text the keyword PRAY to our number 618-777-6779. That will automatically sign you up for those emails. Be on the lookout after you do that for your first email next week. We believe that prayer changes things, and we want you to be a part of The Furnace. And as always, we believe that you were created on purpose with purpose to encounter God, connect with others, serve with excellence, and belong together. We'll see you next week.
All right, hang on. Give me something a little more peppy. Or am I looking at Ben? Was that you playing?
Ben was playing.
Give me something a little more peppy. Good morning, Little Chapel. Gotta get your toe tapping, right? Ladies and gentlemen, we're gonna do the prayer and offering at this part of the service, and then afterwards we're gonna get into worship. So if you would, make your way on in. Ushers, come on forward. These guys are so talented. Waiting on ushers. Hey, got a special guest that's going to be coming up praying over the offering this morning. You certainly don't want to miss that. Anybody enjoyed the fall weather we're having? Ah. Anybody enjoy that the Cardinals haven't mustered very many hits in the last couple of days? There's the Cubs fan section. All right.
That was fun. That was great.
Any ushers? There's ushers.
Do we have the ushers today?
Hey, let's do this one more time.
Oh, no.
Whatever you want, Ben. Just give us something good for offering music.
I don't know. I really do not know what you're going to do.
Do you want a little I'll Fly Away or something?
Oh, yeah, that's a good song. That's an 80s song there. That's the power of love there.
I don't know if that's really offering. Is that the YouTube video?
What?
Isn't that the song
you
did the
YouTube
video?
Yeah, the song that we did the YouTube video. Yeah, same one. Yeah, there you go. You could do that one Sunday. Yeah.
All right. When the Chamness family sits down, we'll go ahead and begin. Hey, how many of you guys know it's good to just laugh sometimes? Amen. Isn't it good just to just be silly? And this is where you guys say, all right, Joe, you're done stalling now, so go ahead and move on so we can get into the presence of God and something more important than you with a microphone. So if you would welcome this morning, I have a young lady who's going to come up and pray over this morning's tithes and offering. I always love having chances to incorporate some of the youth. Miss Coyle, come on up. She's going to lead us this morning. As she is coming up is Brandon and Michelle Segler. Are you guys in here? New baby this morning, Lane Isaac. Let's welcome him this morning. Welcome, Lane. Congratulations, Mom and Dad. Are you ready? Proud of you.
All right. Dear Father God, I pray over the offering. Pray that you'd bless the offering, God, and that you'd just be with us through this day, and that we'd really focus on you, God. In your name I pray. Amen.
Let's all stand together and get ready for some worship. I raise a hallelujah.
Sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
Power. To the King of Kings, you are my everything.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. I know the night won't last. Your word will to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your still in your
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. Still in your hands. This is my
If he's been faithful to you, can you just raise up a shout and a praise to him this morning for who is worthy? He is faithful. He who has been faithful to do it shall do it again. And I just feel like the Lord has positioned hope over you and your families. What we hope for is not a one-time thing. We hope in a God who is faithful. If you believe that, give somebody a high five and say, get ready. God is faithful. You can't get away from his faithfulness. It's who he is. He is faithful. It's not only an attribute of the character and nature of God. He is faithful. Tell your other neighbor, he is faithful. He is faithful. What he has done, he will do again. He is faithful. And I just feel like the Lord just wants to settle in someone's heart this morning that he is faithful to do it again. And again, and again, and again. He is faithful. He is faithful. I believe it. I believe it because I've experienced it. If you've experienced the faithfulness of God, can you just rejoice this morning? He is faithful. I believe he'll do it again. We're going to sing this bridge one more time just as a declaration of praise. We're just combining our words of faith and encouragement in line with the will of God. Do you know that it is his will to show himself strong on your behalf? That is the will of God. It is his will for him to be faithful to you. So whenever we sing these things, we're just singing giving praise in accordance with what is his will. Whenever we move in accordance with his will, that's called moving in faith. Come on, somebody. So can we just make one more declaration of faith this morning? Let's sing this bridge again. Okay, here's what I need you to do before you sit down. Before you sit down, turn to your favorite neighbor and say, neighbor, you've lost weight. Now hold on, don't sit down yet. Don't sit down yet. Turn to your other neighbor and say, second choice, you look pretty good too. You guys can be seated. Come on, somebody. Oh, man. I love it. I love it. I love it. I love it. God is good. God is good.
Man, oh man. If you believe that, say yes. Come on, that's so much fun. I love just coming together and worshiping as a family and just expecting. I don't know about you guys, but every Sunday when we come together to encounter God, I truly believe that we are coming to encounter God. This is not just something we do to go through the motions. We are coming here for a purpose to encounter the God of all creation. Is that why you're here this morning? Come on, if that's why you're here, let's make some noise, man. This is a good thing. It's a good thing to celebrate and just to come together and just, yes, because God is that good. I'm so excited about this series that we're beginning today. We've been talking about it for over a month, and it's called Power Ballads. Who loves a good old power ballad? Come on, man. These old power ballads, these songs that have stood the test of time, as I have been thinking about these, I'm like, man, there is some rich words within some of these songs that I feel like can actually speak spiritually to a deeper thing that God is wanting to do. As we get into this, you know, I've just kind of been racking my brain over these last couple of months saying, okay, how are we going to do this? How are we going to put this together? And I feel like we've just got something really, really, really good in store. And more importantly, that I feel like God has something just really, really, really good in store for us through this series. You know, there's something about the power that's in a song. How many of you guys know, like, that you can hear a song, and this happens to me now that I'm like officially in my late 30s, right? And some people say, well, that's not old. You guys think it's old, right? I'm 37. That's old, right? Because I remember being over there and thinking that, like, once you turn 35, life was almost over. But, you know, I'm just getting started. I'm thankful for that. But I'll tell you what's cool now, and I know that I'm speaking to somebody who will be able to appreciate this, and one day all of you will too. I remember, guys, there can be a song that comes on, and it will take me back to the first time I ever heard that song and thought, this is an awesome song. There's an old song. Man, some of you guys won't even remember this. Like, this group called Sister Hazel sang this song. It's hard to say what it is I see in you. You guys know that song? Anybody? All right. Guys, I listened to that song. I remember the first time I ever heard that song. I was 15 years old, getting ready to go to summer weights in the morning. I heard it at 5:30 a.m. on the radio. And I said, this song is amazing. All right, first time I ever heard that song. Who remembers the song I'll Be by Edwin McCain? You guys remember that? I'll be your crying shoulder. I'll be love suicide. Yeah, you guys know that song? All right. I listened to that song in my old 82 Chevy, 4 on the floor, 16-inch glass packs, screaming at the top of my lungs because I was dating a girl named Kristen Seltz, thought we were getting married. That was our song. And I remember that stuff. I remember those things. I'm so thankful that that didn't work out because I got an upgrade. Come on, somebody. All right. Is anybody thankful that you got an upgrade in your relationship when you found your spouse? Come on, somebody. That's just good stuff. Guys, I remember how some of these songs can just take us back. And we're talking about these power ballads, and we're going to go through one each week. We were playing one as service was starting. And let me just say this, too. Some of y'all need to make sure your watches and phones are working because we start at 10:35 every Sunday. You know that? Come on now. Hey, I'm not pointing. I'm just saying we start at 10:35. Come on, somebody. I see husbands pointing at their wives. It's not your wife's fault, okay? I'm just saying. But we were playing a song. Who can tell me the name of the song that was playing earlier? Anyone pay attention? Who? I heard it. The song we were starting off with? No, it was originally sang by Miss Dolly Parton, kind of made even more famous by Whitney Houston, a song called I Will Always Love You. Okay, honest time, who in here has had a relationship and that was your song? Yeah, there's some hands going off. There's some hands going up. And who in here that whenever that song goes on, you start playing except for whenever she goes to another register and then you're like, only Whitney can do that. Right? You guys know what I mean. Okay, so there is something powerful about these songs, and I feel like the reason why so many of these ballads have such a deep meaning is because they're tied to a deeper emotion, this emotion of love. So many of these ballads that we've been singing for years and years and years that have stood the test of time have been able to stand because there's a deeper connection than just the lyrics that go along with it or the melodies that the lyrics flow with. There's a deeper connection because these ballads are able to touch into our feelings and our emotions, especially this emotion called love. Love is absolutely like, it's like the driving force in so many people's lives. In fact, whether you realize it or not, love sets the foundation for the life that we're called to live. We all have loved, we all are loving, and I want everyone to know that you are loved, and someone just needs to know that. Love is essential for our life. We were not created, it was never God's intention that we would be without love. Like literally, we were created for love. Do you know that when God created us in his image, it was for the purpose that his love would be poured out on us? We were created for God's love. You are the bullseye for the love of God. You are the bullseye that God's love is able to zero in on and said, everything I've done it for you because I love you. You were created for love. And it was by love that you were created. You were created for his love, by his love, in order that you would love. The word says that we love, that we can love because he what? First loved us. And this is kind of where we're going today, that we need to know that God loves us. It's sad. It's sad for so many people that I see, that I counsel, that I've been with, that they might have an idea or they've heard that God loves them, but they've lived a life without the experience of God's love. I want someone to know today that God's love is an experiential quality that he desires to lavish upon you. He wants you to be sure of his love because his love is real. If you've experienced the love of God, can you just say yes like you mean it? I've experienced the love of God. In fact, this week I made just a simple post on Facebook, and I said, using one word, describe an aspect of the love of God. At first, I said using one verb, and then I quickly realized that not everybody knows the difference between a verb and an adjective. So I simplified it and said, using one word, describe an aspect of the love of God. This morning, I was like, well, I wonder how many comments, because I was getting so many, and I was like, I'm going to reply to all of these. Quickly, I realized it would take too much time. This morning, I checked it, and using one word, I have over 220 responses to this question about people responding to an aspect using one word of the love of God. Let me share with some of these responses. It restores, fulfills, it heals, redeems, it trusts, it frees, it is love, it forgives, it builds, unfailing, it chastens, it's compassionate, supplies, protects, peace, encouraging, unrelenting, awesome, delivers, moving, saving, delivers, real, fathers, surrounds, it's unwavering, it's saturating, it rebuilds, it's forgiving, it redeems, it lifts, it completes, it's personal, it heals, it's empowering, it leads, it restores, it's forgiving, it transforms, it transcends, it's endless, it's undeniable, it's indescribable. These are words that people have written in response to aspects of the love of God. And here's what I love about this post. And I wasn't even planning to talk about this. I wasn't doing it for any other reason than to know how people experience God's love. Here's what's so incredible that I found out just from posting this simple question. These people, many of them, which are you, who have responded to this, they're responding to an aspect. They're responding with an aspect of the love of God that they themselves have experienced. Because the love of God is to be experienced. For those of us who have surrendered our life to Jesus and have repented and asked for forgiveness of our sins, how many of you know that you have been forgiven? And His forgiveness is poured out because He loves us. And for those who have been forgiven, there's an experience that aligns with His love. For those who would say it heals, how many of you have had God bring healing in your life through emotions, maybe in relationships? You've experienced this healing power of God that's manifested because God so loved you. For those who understand that the love of God saturates, it's because they've had an experience that the love of God is so overwhelming that it literally has the power to consume every part of them. That is a saturating love. The love of God empowers. Someone can write that because they've been empowered to love because they've experienced love. True love. Unadulterated, unashamed. Another one said it's relentless. You know, the love of God has been relentlessly poured out for you. He gave everything in a relentless manner so that nothing would be able to stop you or me from experiencing the love of a Father. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful for His love. I'm thankful for His love. So throughout this series, we're going to be focusing on different aspects of love. Love is powerful. In fact, Ben started to play it. Huey Lewis in the Lewis coined a song, said, "The Power of Love." It was prophetic. Huey didn't know I was going to preach on his song, but it's just true. There's power in love. There's power in knowing and experiencing the love of a Father. If you believe that, say yes. And pray with me over this message. Lord, I pray that in the few moments that I have left, that You would help me deliver this word with accuracy and conviction. Holy Spirit, guard my words. Be the filter through which every word passes. I thank You, Lord, that You anoint this word as it goes forth, that You touch everyone, that You would guard my lips, that I would not speak a word that is outside of Your will to be declared. And Lord, I thank You that as You have promised, that Your word will not return void, and that as it goes forth this morning, it will accomplish everything that it is set forth to do, so that it would produce the fruit of the life we have in You in our lives, 30, 60, and 100 fold. If you're ready, say yes. All right, so this morning, very quickly, I'm going to give you seven attributes of the love of God. Seven attributes. This is the message, right? It's not going to be super in-depth, but we need to start with the love of God. We need to start being fully convinced that you are loved, and someone needs to know this, that you are worthy to be loved. So we're going to be going through seven attributes of God, seven attributes of His love, looking at seven experiences that people had with His love through seven stories that we find in His word. So let's go ahead and get started. The first one is in John chapter 8. So you can turn with me to John chapter 8, and the NASB is what I'm reading from. The words will be up there on the screen with me in just a moment. So you can follow along on the screen or in your Bible, on your phone, whatever you are reading from. So let's go ahead and just get started. John 8, verses 1 through 11. And this is what the word says. But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives early in the morning, and He came again into the temple, and all the people were coming to Him. And He sat down and began to teach them. The scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman caught in adultery. And having set her in the center of the courtyard, they said to Him, "Teacher, this woman has been caught in adultery, in the very act." Verse 5, "Now the law of Moses commanded us to stone such a woman. What then do you say?" And they were saying this, testing Him, so that they might have grounds for accusing Him. But Jesus stooped down and with His finger began to write in the ground. But then they persisted asking Him, and He straightened up. And He said to them, "He who is without sin among you, let him be the first to throw a stone at her." Again, He stooped down and wrote on the ground. Verse 9, when they heard it, they began to go out one by one, beginning with the older ones. And He was left alone with the woman, right where she was in the center of the court. Straightening up, Jesus said to her, "Woman, where are they? Did no one condemn you?" She said, no one, Lord. And Jesus said, I do not condemn you either. From now on, or he says, for I do not condemn you either. Go from now on and sin no more. The first aspect of the love of God, the first one that we need to experience or that we need to talk about today is forgiveness. How many of you know that forgiveness, the forgiveness that only God can offer through his son Jesus Christ, was a radical act of love? It's a radical act of love. And so we see here in this scripture that this woman, she was caught in the act of adultery. Literally in the act of adultery. And she is brought to Jesus in front of all the men of the temple in the court. So if you can imagine this with me, you have this woman who, if she was lucky, had enough time to maybe grab a sheet to cover up with, and she's thrust into the middle of the court, and she knows at this moment, according to the law, that these might be the final breaths that she takes. That this could be it, because by the law, according to the religion that they followed, that she was worthy to die for her act. It's funny that the act of the man was not mentioned in this story. You ever think about that? The guy said no. But it's true. So you have this woman who is before Jesus. Everyone else is saying, Jesus, according to the law, we are Jews. We live by the law. The law provides the way that we live. According to the law, this woman is worthy to be stoned, but we want to hear what you have to say. In other words, now it says they were looking for grounds to accuse him. What does that mean? If Jesus would have said something contrary to the law itself, outside of a personal experience, if Jesus would have said something contrary to the law, then they would have had grounds to accuse him and punish him. So that's why those words in there, in order to accuse him, are stated. But they're asking Jesus, this is what the law says, this woman is worthy of death, what do you say? And in wisdom, he begins to write on the ground. And you know, he stands up and he makes the statement, he who is without sin, go ahead and throw the first stone. He who is able among you, all of you men, you religious men who have never messed up, who have never broken the law, which, by the way, is impossible. That's why we needed a Savior. Come on, somebody. There were 613 laws in the law that one would have to obey to be called righteous. And so the reality is nobody could do it. And that's why Jesus came to be appropriation, to pay the penalty for the sin that we've all committed. Jesus knew that. And so he says, whoever hasn't missed one of these laws, go ahead. Throw the first stone. And can't you see that these people are, that they have stones ready. And Jesus is riding in the sand. And this woman, can you imagine her covered in shame, knowing that she did wrong? How many of you guys know that whenever we are in sin, there is a knowing of wrongdoing? This woman is caught in sin, knowing that she has done wrong. And I can imagine her when she hears these words, he who is without sin, go ahead and throw the first stone. I imagine that in this moment, she might be trying to protect herself from what she's sure was coming, the first stone. And she waited, and instead of hearing the windup of a man getting ready to throw a stone, the first thing she hears is, one by one, stones, instead of being thrown, are dropped. And then when she looks up, come on somebody, and then when she looks up, the only person she sees is Jesus. How many of you know that that is exactly the reality that we've been brought into? When we have been caught in the very act of our sin, covered in shame and discontent and hurt, whenever we felt the lowest, he called us by name and we looked up and there he was. Instead of running from us, he came to us and said, where are your accusers to this woman? And she says, there are none. And what did he say? He says, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. What an act of forgiveness, family. What an act of forgiveness to one who was worthy to receive punishment. How many of you know, because of your sin, yes, you have sinned. You were worthy of punishment. That's true. The Word of God says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And the wages for sin is death. That's what I deserved for my sin. That's what she deserved for her sin. But Jesus, what a perfect picture of what he does for us. What a perfect picture of what he does for us. When this woman was over here, when this woman was over here, covered in shame, in the middle of her sin, and the men of the law and judgment were on this side, they were ready to condemn and kill because the wages of sin is death. But in a perfect representation of what Christ has done for myself and for all of you, he stepped in and became the mediator. He said, in order to get to her, you have to come through me. And that's what he's done for each and every one of us. He has become the mediator of a better covenant. He stepped in and made a way so that we wouldn't die in our sin. What an act of love forgiveness is. What an act of love that forgiveness is. And then he says to her, I don't condemn you. Go and sin no more. Powerful word here. Powerful word. That word in the Greek, I promise you the next six are going to go a lot faster than this, but we got to lay this foundation. That word go in the Greek means to follow. It means to follow or become one's adherent. To pursue a journey that one has entered, to follow someone, to become one's adherent. That word adherent means to adhere. That's where we get our word adhere, to comply, to come under. So what Jesus is saying, he's not telling her, okay, I've stepped in, now go away. That's not what he's saying to her, is it? You see, what in our language looks like go, Jesus was saying, neither do I condemn you, now follow. Come near. Become my adherent. In other words, he's saying go, right? Come, follow, and as you follow me, how many of you guys know that Jesus would never give you a command that the Spirit of God would not empower you to complete? So here you go, this woman, he's saying, come, follow me. As you follow me, you'll be able to accomplish the act of sinning no more. How many of you know that we can't do what we're called to do outside of a relationship with Jesus? What a perfect picture this story is illustrating for us to see that the only way that this woman could be empowered to sin no more is by living in right relationship with Jesus. That's the only power you have. I promise you right now, I'm preaching better than someone's giving me credit for this morning. This is just the absolute truth. You have no hope to live up to your calling outside of a relationship with Jesus. And that is what Jesus was inviting her into. Verses 3 and 5, we see the purpose of law and judgment. Judgment, the purpose of the judgment that they were trying to release was to lead to punishment. But love flips the script. Touch your neighbor and say, flip the script. Love flips the script. It means it does it different. Religion judges you because of your sin, but Jesus sets you free from your sin. Come on, somebody. Religion and law judges you because of your sin, but Jesus sets you free from your sin. Meaning that whenever you are walking with Jesus, following him, you are empowered to be set free from anything sin could produce in your life. That's forgiveness. And that's love. That's love. Touch somebody and tell them that's love. If you've been forgiven, you've experienced love. If you've surrendered your life to Jesus, you've experienced forgiveness. He has wiped your sin as far as the east is from the west, never to be remembered again. Guys, that is forgiveness. And that forgiveness is only made possible because he loves you. Are you thankful that he loves you? I'm thankful that he loved me enough. And what's really cool is that he loves you in spite of you. Come on, somebody. Number two, like I said, we'll go faster now. The love of God is compassionate. compassionate. Mark 9, 35 through 38, I'm reading out of the CEB. It says, this is the Common English Bible. It says, Jesus traveled among all the cities and the villages, teaching in their synagogues, announcing the good news of the kingdom, healing every disease and every sickness. Now, when Jesus saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were troubled and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the size of the harvest is bigger than you can imagine, but there are few workers. Therefore, plead with the Lord of the harvest to send out workers for his harvest. The Greek word here is way too long to pronounce, but the definition of compassion in the Greek for this Greek word, it means moved to the depths of one's being. So in context with the scripture, it's saying Jesus seeing them was moved from the depths of his being. We read compassion, but what we see is something much deeper whenever we begin to study the scripture. That Jesus seeing them, he didn't just have compassion. No, he was moved from the very depths of his being. Have you ever been moved from the very depths of your being? This is Jesus in this moment. He's moved from the depths of his being. And it's just like, guys, these crowds. We are just like these crowds. And everything that we're going through, it comes right back to us, because the life of Jesus that we saw him live is the illustration of the Father's heart towards us. So the way that Jesus responded to people, he's still responding to us. How many of you guys know that it is the compassionate love of a father that gave everything so that you could be brought close again? It's the compassionate love of a father that would send his one and only begotten son, who knew no sin, to literally become sin so that you and I would become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Compassion is a radical act of love. I'm thankful for the compassion that I've experienced from the basis of love from a father who loves me. Compassion is birthed from love. Number three, his love is merciful. Who's thankful for mercy? Everybody ought to say yes. We'll try that again. Who's thankful for mercy? We read in Luke chapter 5, verses 27 through 32, I'll just kind of give you a brief overview of this story. We see Jesus again. He's doing what Jesus does, and he comes across a tax collector by the name of Levi. We also call him Matthew. Levi is one. He was a Jew brought up in Judaism, brought up memorizing the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible. He studied the law. He knew the law. But as he got older, the attraction of sin pulled him away from what he knew was right. And now Levi, this tax collector, was one who would steal from his own people. Most likely, being a tax collector meant that he was a sinner in the religion, in the religious people's viewpoint and eyes. A family who had a child, a son or a daughter, who was reviewed and seen as a sinner, would excommunicate their child from their life. Are you getting a picture of Levi's circumstance in this moment? He grew up, let's just call it like this, he grew up in church and then went his own way. Does anybody have a testimony like Levi? Am I just me? Okay, that's all right, that's all right. I grew up in church, I went my own way, but Jesus found me. Come on, somebody. Levi grew up in church, went his own way, was doing his own thing, living in sin, reviled by his people, rejected by his family, and Jesus found him. And Jesus gave him the same invitation that he's given each and every one of us. He said, Levi, come follow me. And in a moment, Levi's life was transformed. He left in a moment. He left the sin that so easily entangled his life because he received a call into something better. How many of you know that Jesus is calling you into something better? So here's Levi. He leaves what was. He leaves the sin and the issues that had trapped his life to follow the one who called his name. And what's the first thing that Levi does? The first thing that Levi does that night, he says, Jesus, you've got to meet my friends. And so he went to his friends and he said, guys and gals, there's this man that transformed my life. I'm going to have a party. I want you to come because you got to meet Jesus too. I wish some of us would get excited like Levi because of the work that Jesus has done in our life and would tell all of our friends, you got to meet this Jesus. He transformed me. He made me brand new. I'm no longer who I was. And so we see Jesus in the midst of all of the other sinners in Levi's life. And here's the Pharisees again, asking the question, does he not know that he's hanging out with a bunch of sinners? How many of you guys know that Jesus never let people's issues get in the way of what he wanted to do? Jesus was able to love people perfectly in spite of their issues. How many of you know that Jesus is able, was able, and still is able to love you in spite of your issues? Touch your neighbor, have some fun, and tell him, neighbor, hey, say it like you mean it. Help me, guys, if you want to get done. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, you got some issues. Come on, somebody. Jesus never let people's issues get in the way of what he wanted to do. Oh, there's sinners there? I'm showing up. Oh, people have issues? Let me go hang out with them. Because guess what? They don't need to continue in their sin. They need to encounter Jesus because that's where transformation takes place. Don't let people's issues get in the way of sharing the truth that you've experienced. Levi said, this dude changed my life. He's got to meet all my friends. What a testimony. Levi was one who deserved punishment, again, according to the law. The love of God is merciful. What does mercy do? A very simple definition of mercy is that it takes away the punishment that you deserved. That's mercy. That's mercy. One time, Titus did something that was unbecoming of a young man, and he was about ready to receive a punishment. I won't tell you what type of punishment that he was going to receive, but it was not one that he was looking forward to. And as he was sitting there looking at me, I'm ready to deliver the punishment that he deserved for the action that he committed. He looked at me with tears coming down his face. And I don't know if he was just playing me, Or if he was sincere, but either way, it worked, okay? He looked at me with tears just streaming down his face, and like I said, I don't know if it was because he was afraid of the punishment or there was true repentance, but he looked at me and said, Dad, I'm so sorry. And I said, mercy! I said, son, I'm going to give you mercy. And this is before he goes, what's mercy? He's like, what's mercy? I said, no, mercy's a good thing. Mercy's a good thing. Mercy takes away what you deserve. I said, you deserve to be punished. Yeah, you did something wrong. I know. But I'm going to give you mercy. And then I was able to say, you know what, Titus? It's exactly what God has done for us. We've all messed up. We've all done something wrong. But when we come to him and say, Dad, I'm sorry, he says, mercy. Mercy is an act of love poured out by our Heavenly Father. If you've experienced the mercy of God, can you just raise a hand and say yes? You see, guys, what I'm doing through this, I'm hoping the Holy Spirit is just moving in your lives to let you know whether you feel it in this moment or not, you are loved. You are valued. It's not just about a feeling. It's about knowing from experience what God has done. Number four, it restores. God's love restores. I know I could go through this crowd this morning and ask for testimonies of how God's love has restored places that have been broken in your life, hearts, emotions, relationships, because the love of God is restoring. An example that we have from the Word of God is Jesus perfectly restoring Peter, the disciple, the one who often put his foot in his mouth, that spoke before he talked. I'm thankful that none of you are like Peter. Come on, somebody. All right. But here's Peter, right? He's before Jesus is crucified, and Jesus lets him know, dude, you are going to deny me three times. Peter says, it'll never happen. Never going to happen, Jay. If I have to die with you, I'm going to die. Jay. If I have to die with you, I'll die today. You know the story. He followed Jesus at a distance. A servant girl, you're with him. No, that wasn't me. Someone else. I know that I've seen you with him. No, that wasn't me. Another servant. Man, the way you talk gives it away. And he began to curse and vehemently deny knowing Jesus. The rooster crowed. And so now Peter, can you see him in this moment? He just said, Jesus, I'm never going to leave you. I'm never going to forsake you. I'll die with you. I'm your ride or die. I'm with you. I won't go. I'm right here. He denies him, does the very thing that Jesus said. And now Peter no longer sees himself worthy of the calling that Jesus called him to. We know this, that during Jesus' death, while he was dead, Peter was with the disciples. And Peter's like, I don't know what to do anymore. I had purpose. I had a calling. I guess that's gone because I screwed up. How many of you guys have believed the lie that because you screwed up, that God can no longer use you? This is Peter. I screwed up. I'm done. I'm going fishing. Because Peter was a fisherman in the past. So Peter, because he messed up, he allowed shame to move him away from where Jesus called him. He said, I guess I'm done. The last 3.5 years was fun. I'm going fishing. And then John chapter 21 comes along. I'm skipping a lot, but just so you kind of get the preface of what I'm talking about. Jesus is now, he's been resurrected. He's back alive, and he's meeting with Peter around a fire, eating some fish. And he asks him three times, Peter, do you love me? Do you love me more than all of these? Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And they correspond together. And Jesus goes on to tell Peter, he says, Peter, this call that I have on your life will cost you your life. He's telling him, Peter, you will die if you respond to this call again. You see, Peter, in this moment, was willing to surrender the very thing just a little while ago he tried to spare, and that was his life. He told him, Peter, this will cost you your life. Now, follow me. You see, the love of God, it restores us. It restores us. It resets the standard. It restores us to something that he's called us to. Peter, if you remember, why is this so significant? Because when Peter first met Jesus, what's the first thing that Jesus said? He said, come and follow me. He said, get off the boat and follow me. So just like in the beginning, Jesus saw Peter on the boat, and he said it again. After they had sat down and talked, he says, come and follow me. Letting Peter know that my call for you has not changed. I have not changed my mind. You still have a purpose. Your mistake can't screw up my plan. Come on, somebody. Someone needs to know that your mistake can't screw up the plan of God in your life if you would again choose to come back in line and follow him. Someone say, God's not done. God's not done with you. He's not done with your call. So don't let the tool of the enemy that would produce shame to remove you from where God is calling you to. The love of God is restoring in nature. Who is thankful that God's love has restored you? That's what he does. Number 5, God's love is extraordinary. His love is extraordinary. The Apostle Paul, one who encountered the love of God in an absolute life-changing way, writes about this extraordinary love. The word extraordinary, part of that definition means limitless. Paul says, I ask that you'll have the power to grasp love's width, its length, its height, and its depth. Together with all believers, I ask that you know the love of Christ that is beyond knowledge, so that you will be filled entirely with the fullness of God. His extraordinary love, Paul writes in Romans 5:8, was demonstrated. That God proves his love for us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. That's an extraordinary type of love, church. He didn't wait till you were cleaned up, dressed up, looking good. While you were still a sinner, he died for you. It's one thing to give your life for someone who you know loves you. It's a whole other thing to give your life for someone who might never will. While you were still a sinner, Christ died for you. While you were still lost in tribulation and sin, Jesus came and gave everything for you, demonstrating his love poured out for you. His love is extravagant. Number six, I saw the band come up, so as they're coming out, we'll finish this thing. Number six, God's love is unconditional. Just think about that word for a moment. That God's love is unconditional. Very simply means that his love for you is not based on what you can do to earn it. His love for you is not based on what you could do to figure it out, to perform well enough. His love for you is just because you're you. Come on, somebody. You just need to know that God's love for you is not based on the merit of who you are or what you've accomplished. His love for you is for you because you were created by love, for love, to love, and that's good enough. His love that is unconditional was demonstrated in Jesus, who loved so well. Jesus loved everybody, didn't he? It's unconditional. Jesus loved Philip and Nathanael. Nathanael, in whom Jesus said, there's an Israelite in whom there's no deceit. So Jesus loved the righteous. He loved the good guys. Jesus loved the sinners. He loved Levi when he was still trapped in sin. Jesus loved prostitutes out of sin. Jesus was one who did not restrict his love based on what someone was involved in. Jesus just loved. It was unconditional. Who's thankful for this unconditional love? Jesus loved those who were possessed by demons. Remember Mary Magdalene, whom seven demons were driven out? Love. Jesus loved the men who followed him. He loved the men that rejected him. He loved the women that would come after him. He loved the women who didn't. He loved the children. He just loved. The mark of those who would say that they follow Jesus is not based on what church they go to, what extracurricular ministries that they give to, or what they're a part of. The mark of those who say they follow Jesus is in their ability to love well. That was so much better than anyone gave me credit for. The mark, the litmus test for your life, hear me now, on whether you love Jesus is in your ability to love well. And they would know them, by how? By the church they go to, right? They would know them by the fact that they do a lot of good things in the community. They would know them because they don't screw up all the time. No. And they would know them by the love they have for one another. Love, come on. It's unconditional. We look to him who is the author and perfecter of our faith. If he loves unconditionally, you and I ought to be praying, Lord, help me to love unconditionally. Lastly, when you experience the love of God, here's what it does. The love of God compels. That word compels means to go, to do. You see, love should lead to action. When I've experienced this transforming love of God that has forgiven me, redeemed me, restored me, set me free, when I've experienced and encountered this love, guys, it should compel me to do something. What is this love compelling you to do in your life? Are you responding to this love that He is lavishly pouring out on you? The love of God compels. There's something about the love of God that has the power to move you to action. As we read, Paul wrote that we would know God's love, the height, the depth, the width, that we would know it. That word know translates to mean to know by experience. The love of God is not something that I'm just talking about here. The love of God was meant for you to experience. We've talked about these different experiences of love that we have. That word seven, okay, so like here's, we're tying this all together. Please don't leave. We're gonna be done in 4 minutes. It was not an accident that God gave me seven attributes of love. Even as I was thinking, I was praying, God, why seven? Because literally there's 200 on my Facebook right now. Why seven? And then I was just reminded that that word seven is the number of completion, perfection. And even this morning, the way that I feel like the Lord outlined this message is two ways. That He wants you to be made complete. One of the aspects of love, this healing that takes place, is this word sozo, which means complete, lacking nothing. He wants you to be made complete. He wants you to be whole. He wants you to be perfected. But understand this. Seven is the number of completion. You and I cannot be complete absent the love of God. You were not created to live this life that you've been given without the tangible love of God pouring out on you. Without God's love manifesting on you, without you receiving this love, you are incomplete. The love of God, it completes you. You were dead in your sin. You were separated, alienated from God because of choices that you've made. And even some in here, I'm not being mean, I'm just telling you the truth. Because of sin and choices of your life, you are separated from God. If you are separated, then you're not complete. But there's something about coming to this place where you say, Jesus, forgive me, I'm yours, I receive this love. Now all of a sudden, what you were created for comes alive, and it's only when His love encounters you that you can be made as you were created, and that is complete. He desires that His love would complete you this morning. Everyone in here, would you please bow your head and close your eyes? Just simply landing this message. Paul's prayer, again, as no one is looking around, no one is leaving. Paul's prayer is the same prayer that I proclaim over you this day. That you would have the power to grasp love's width, its length, its height, and its depth. That you would know the love of Christ that is beyond knowledge. If you're here today, and maybe you've been in this place where you've never surrendered your life to Jesus, that this love of God, this love of a Father is a foreign concept to you. If you're here this day and that's where you are, I want you to know that His love is ready to be poured out on any who would come to Him. Maybe you're here today and you have experienced that, but maybe you've walked away from that. Maybe you're engaged in some stuff that you know does not please God and you've chosen to remove yourself. And now shame, just like Peter, has kept pushing you away, pushing you away, pushing you away. It's the lie of the devil. But now the heart of God is drawing you, saying that his love has not waned, his love has not faded, and he wants to restore a life that has walked away. If you're here today and you need to surrender your life to Jesus, or you need to rededicate your life to Christ, in just a moment, I want you to raise your hand as high as you can. And then I'm going to ask after, as soon as we're done here, that you come meet me under this freedom banner. And we're just going to pray together. I want to personally meet you and pray with you while every head is bowed and every eye is closed. If you are here this day and you're saying, man, I need this love to be real in my life because I've tried to do it on my own. It's not working. I've never surrendered my life to Christ, or I've walked away from what I know is right, but I know that something is changing, that God's love is compelling and bringing me back. If that's you, when I count to three, I want you to hold your hand in the air as high as you can. The love of God, which knows no bounds and knows no measure, is waiting to be poured out. If that's you, raise your hand on three. One, two, three. Raise your hands right now. Is there anyone right now that would raise your hand and say, yep, that's me. That's me. All right, I see you. I see you. I see you. I see you. Here, just keep your hands up. I want you to know that I see you. Look at me if your hand is raised. I see you. I see you back. I see you here. As soon as we're done, meet me under this freedom banner, okay? You come meet me. We're going to pray. God is good. Is there anyone else? Just slip your hand up and yep, that's me. That's me. Anyone else? Okay. If you're thankful for his love, could you just respond with a praise worthy of his name? Can you just begin to praise him and thank him for his love? Jesus, I thank you for your love. Would you stand to your feet right now? Let me pray over you as you're going. For those who responded, again, just come meet me under this banner. It will not take any time at all. Right now, everyone just lift your hands to heaven and say this with me. Say, Father, thank you for loving me perfectly, without condition. Thank you for your love that forgives, that's compassionate, that's merciful, that restores, that's extraordinary, that's unconditional, and that compels. We love you, Lord. We thank you. We praise you. Go before us and prepare the way that we would love well. All these things we ask in your mighty name. And everyone said, amen, 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 amen. God is good. Have a great week, everybody. Amen.